Our first guest is one of the most influential comedians of our time. This man was the first stand-up comedian to ever appear on the cover of Time magazine, and his offhand and irreverent approach to public officials helped change our political system. Folks, please say hello to Mort Saul. A little lull before we bring you up.
Did I change the political system?
That's what it says right there, Mort.
What it all is today?
Yeah, we have you to thank for that, I guess.
You read about the Drug Enforcement Administration wants to, they wanted the clearance last Thursday. They asked for this and was denied, by the way, to shoot down any plane in which there are drugs. Mm-hmm. I'd hate to see that MGM flight from L.A. going down over Jamaica Bay every afternoon, but I'm sorry. Contemporary humor.
Let's before we get to anything else you want to discuss, there's an aspect of your life that I've always been interested in and was never, of course, able to live it firsthand, and that's when you were working clubs.
Yeah.
And we're talking about it, an era that was in the 50s sometime and went right up to the mid-60s.
60s, 70s, and 80s.
All right, but I mean the first great clubs, the ones that I always hear guys talking about, the ones that are now longer there.
Sure, the Hungry Eye.
The Hungry Eye in San Francisco.
The Crescendo in L.A.
And was there Mr. Kelly's in Chicago? Was that in there also?
Yes. Yeah.
And what in New York did you work?
The Blue Angel here with Jonathan Winters.
Right.
And, we were all around.
Now, were these actual clubs? Because there are comedy clubs now that are not really clubs, are they?
No, these were like bon vivant kind of executives and black tie.
A big night out.
Yeah, and you'd open for a singer, you know, Peggy Lee or Julie London or something.
And actual supper clubs. Now, what was that exciting? Was it glamorous, or was it? Is this just something I have a false impression of?
Well, it was a drudgery, but you learned how to do it.
Yeah, and is that where you started being a stand-up comedian?
I started in San Francisco, The Hungry Eye.
Now, how does that work? Because now I think anybody who's interested in it understands you go to California, you put your name on a list, sooner or later, you get a show.
Yeah.
but in those days, if you wanted to practice stand-up comedy, how did it begin? What was the first step? Who did you talk to? How did it work?
Well, in San Francisco, you went to the Hungry Eye, which had folk singers.
Right.
A place with a brick wall, you know, and no liquor, 25 cents to get in, beer and wine, and American cheese and white bread, a lunch meat smorgasbord, and you made your own sandwiches there. And they had folk singers, and I would... open for a folk singer, and if you were funny, they might laugh. If you weren't funny, they thought it was whimsical. They tried to get with it. It was pretty yuppie, I guess, maybe.
Yeah.
You know? And,
Now, forgive my ignorance on this and many other topics, but are we talking about beatniks, or was this after beatniks, before?
Beatniks first. Beatniks were better because they wrote something.
Yeah.
They didn't just rent tapes like this crowd. This was Kerouac, etc. Then we go to yuppies. You know, those people who, somebody said the definition of a yuppie was somebody who thinks it's courageous to eat in a restaurant that hasn't been reviewed yet. Right? So anyway, back to the clubs.
Yeah.
And then you'd get up and... nobody would laugh. In my case, it took about 3 months to get a laugh, you know, because I was talking in a strange language. Yeah. And I was dealing in politics in 1953. And then we finally broke through with one joke.
Which was?
Which was, at the time of Senator McCarthy, not your friend Gene, but Joe. And Dick Nixon. And the joke, it had to do with blacklisting. The joke was, every time the Russians put an American in jail, we put an American in jail to show them they can't get away with it. And then you were all right. And then, so it was this kind of subtle humor. And then I came to New York, and Jonathan and I were at the Blue Angel.
Yeah. Who else was in that group?
Lenny, mm-hmm. Bruce was around.
Now, were you guys pretty much on the same level, or was one a little farther ahead of the others?
Well, he can incite people more than I could, you know. We worked together in San Francisco. He was at a club called the Purple Onion, and I was at the Hungry Eye, and they were across the street from each other. And he had a deal with the club owner to pay him every night. He never trusted club owners. Mm-hmm. And he had a Volvo station wagon, and if they didn't pay him every night when they closed out of the receipts in the cash register, he would take all the furniture out of the club, you know, tables mm-hmm. and chairs, and put it in the Volvo, held hostage till he got his money.
Yeah.
When he was busted for profanity, you know, they had police in front who would listen, you know. He never knew they were plainclothes police, even though they had white socks and rather short haircuts and all. But he never caught on. And then he, one of his devices was to swear in Yiddish. But then they got bilingual police, you know, to sit in front. So he'd swear and they'd arrest him.
Yeah.
And I would go back and do his show and collect and go down and bail him out.
Right.
On at the San Vicente and Santa Monica Boulevard at sheriff's station,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Remember. So I only did 12 minutes in those days, see, so I could do his show too. And the star would do about an hour, you know, Peggy Lee or whoever. And a lot of people who see me now, you know, they'll say, well, gee, now you do an hour and a half, what happened to your discipline? So yeah. I always say, well, there wasn't that much wrong then, so I could cover it faster. Anyway, I would do his show, and then I would go back and might do my show across the street, and I would do his show, and I'd go back and do my show. And we did three shows that.
Yeah.
And it was a big convention of doctors in town for the American Medical Association. They're all reeling around the street without their wives, and they've got those buttons on. It says, hi, my name is Fred, you know, Western Regional AMA. So I'd finished. His second show was going back to do my second show, and it's across the street. These three doctors came lurching toward me, and a guy said, hey, kid, there's a guy in the other club doing all your material. So,
I'm fairly well confused.
So now,
I want to talk a little bit more about this, because I can't talk to anybody else about it. You're,
really?
You're the perfect person here.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, all right. We'll do a commercial here. We'll be right back with you. Mark Saul is here. You know, you said something that went right by, and if you stop and think about it,
awesome.
It's inconceivable.
What?
That they were waiting for him to swear on stage so they could arrest him.
Oh, yeah, I did say that, and it went...
I know, but I mean, if you stop and consider, if you go into any comedy club anywhere in the country, it's likely you will hear somebody not swear. You know, I mean, it's just the way things have turned upside down completely. But that for in those days, you could be arrested for using swear words.
Yeah, that's standard at comedians' equipment now. It's a standard as, hi, how are you guys? I feel pretty good. I just came out here from New York.
Right.
Boy, is it hard to get a pizza in this town.
Yeah. But, same kind of deal.
But it's true. It would be hard now. They dissipated so much profanity that it would be hard to let people know you were angry by cursing.
Mm-hmm.
It's like...
Sure.
Our friend Mark Russell said, you know, Madeline Murray, the famous atheist, her son became a Catholic. And I said to him, Mark, why? And he said he didn't know what to say when his mother sneezed. So just a joke, folks. We didn't mean any harm.
Are there jokes that you used in the very early days that are now applicable in 1988 that you can change a little and use them as well?
Oh, yeah. I suppose you could say... Nixon's going on Mount Rushmore, both faces. And there's somebody you'd probably like to apply that now to now.
Yeah.
There's some jokes that won't die, and of course there's some things that are extremely perishable.
Well, let's talk about the guys who are running for that office right now.
Yeah.
Speaking of perishable. who gets your attention? Who do you like to work on? Who are you having fun with? Who do you have sincere interest in?
I was in the White House Correspondents' Dinner this year. With the president, and by the way, you'll love this. Jerry Falwell led the prayer, mm-hmm. and he turns to me and he said, "Would you like to pray with us?" How about that? So, you know, if somebody had said that 30 years ago, I might have had a different life.
Yeah.
So I realized that. So I joined arms with Jerry Falwell, Sam Donaldson, who then joined arms with Ronald Reagan. There were all of us, you know me.
Forgive me again, but how does this happen? I mean, you were an outlaw. You were the guy on the fringe, and now you're locking arms with Sam Donaldson, Jerry Falwell, and the president getting ready to, I don't know.
That's right.
And doesn't that seem odd to you now?
Well, they, you know, they hired a comedian for the night to address the reporters.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that was.
Oh, so just a gig for you.
They're up close. It's interesting about Falwell, you know. We put our heads down, you know. For the prayer, you know, I'd say you do it, and if you've never done it, like I didn't. And as I did, you know, careful to tie a ground wire around my ankle in case, you know. And I looked up, and Falwell said to me, "We're not through yet."
Oh.
So he had a longer agenda than I did. You meet them as you go. I would say the bonus of this job, in my view, Dave, is getting to meet them. You know, I met the Reagan socially, but I met him when he was out of work.
Mm.
You know, I'm great with lost causes. I mean... you're right. I mean, they're all friends of mine. Gene McCarthy's a friend of mine. General Haig is a friend of mine.
Yeah. Now, is he is a candidate or not a candidate?
Yeah, he's a candidate. Yeah. They're doing a fundraiser in at Philadelphia on the 29th.
Now, do you think that's a good idea?
What's that, a fundraiser?
Well, no.
Or his
no.
being a candidate?
Yeah, that he would be running for this.
Well, yeah, he's going to make it kind of spicy. You know, it's a good idea to get some choice in there.
And Gary Hart, quickly, anything here?
No. I was going to say that... I thought you did everything.
Yeah.
I would say the scandal was a cynical attempt to humanize Hart. That's what I always felt. I never believed a word of it, but oh well.
Time has gotten away from us here. It's my fault because I wanted to talk about, and we didn't even really get a
we'll
chance
to
talk about
We'll have to meet at the
it.
Friars.
All right.
Take
we'll
a steam
over
and talk
steam.
About all
That's
this.
Right. Anyway, come back anytime you're in this area, Mort.
Thank
good to
you,
see
Dave.
You. Thank
good
you for being
you.
Here.
We have to applause for staying here.